We're here at Mobile World Congress 2019 in Barcelona, and I'm joined by Thomas Kinnman. Hi, Thomas, how are you?
I'm just fine. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks so much for catching up with me. Great to see you again. Now, Thomas is the head of solution line analytics and assurance at Ericsson, and we're going to dive into that in a little more in that role. But I'd like to jump straight in with a quick question for you. I saw you put out a press release last week about what you're doing with Ericsson's expert analytics, and I would really love to get your insight into kind of what you released and what that actually entails.
Yep, thank you. No, it was a press release with Telefónica and MotorStorm in Mexico. So they are now joining our community of customers, which is rapidly growing. So very glad to have them on board. It's still under deployment. So of course they have high expectations to make sure that they can use this CM platform to improve their end user experience. So it's cutting across marketing, customer care, operations, engineering. It's all about the democratizing the data to, of course, to use it in the best possible way to, of course, you know, help them with the revenue growth, help them with operational efficiency. So very good to have them on board, and of course, happy to, of course, have them go live later on this year.
Oh, congratulations. And look, I think the whole quality assurance, the network management platforms, et cetera, I mean, you've been doing some very smart stuff for decades and decades. Yeah. You've got Neil Lilly stuff around the insurance component. You've had the acquisition of Cenix and now what you're doing. I'd like to dive into that a bit more, but just where's the fit for what you're doing now? Where are the sort of typical use cases that you're applying this to? What are the big wins for customers that are applying the, artificial intelligence and AI machine learning that you're working on? Where does this apply from a use case point of view, from a customer point of view?
I think number one, you know, operators still, they sit on this gold mine of data. So they still have, of course, the first hurdle is just gather that data and start to correlating it.
Right.
Trying to understand the customers for different perspectives. And as I said, as in the Telefónica press release, you can use that type of data to, of course, make your operations more efficient.
Mm-hmm.
You can make it more meaningful for people in, for example, marketing to better understand their customers, reduce churn or create more upsells.
Yep.
But ultimately, it is, of course, customers, when they complain, how can you improve the experience if they call in? If they only, know who you are and, they can help you faster, that understanding boosts the experience so much. So we cut across the full organization. Now we also have customers looking into how to use the data for, strategic decisions. Where should I plan my 5G network? Where do I need to build out?
Yeah.
So there are so many aspects. All this data, of course, need to collect it, correlate it, and then, of course, you can use it for different reasons. But equally important is, of course, where should you start? These big bang approaches can be quite difficult, big transformation. So we have some customers that go big bang. Some just start small, and for example, a hot topic right now is introduction of voice over LTE or voice over Wi-Fi.
Yep.
And when you're going from the car, switching from Wi-Fi to Volta, there are a lot of things that might go wrong.
Indeed.
In a complex multi-vendor environment. So of course, you need a solution that cuts across. Is it a device-related problem? Is it a radio problem? Is it a Wi-Fi?
Yeah.
Is it a core network? So what we can do is, of course, to help pinpoint that and preferably fix it before it happens.
And where to focus that resource and time and energy and investment for not just the break fix, but also the proactive approach of sort of resolving the issue permanently, right?
Correct. And that's where AI come in, of course, so, to have more predictable analytics, to see the trends before and see predict where might this go.
And I think one of the big things that I got from your press release was that one of the big focuses across Ericsson now is the whole end-to-end story. And it seems to me that now what you've been able to do is look at the data lakes and databases and logs and so forth that people had historically and apply a very deep and broad longitudinal view to this data set and rationalize the data and get to the point where they can make data-driven decisions. We hear about in the traditional unicorns and startups and enterprise. Now telco seems to be applying this, which I think is exciting because it seems to me that it brings down a whole range of things. It's rapid decision making, faster time to market, lower investment cost to get up and running, and a more agile approach to being able to deal with what customers are asking for. Because we hear about this celebrity customer experience, and we think it's a bit of a hoo-ha. But I'm in that thing. I want the celebrity customer experience. I want my telco to know what I want, and I actually prefer them to tell me before I know.
Correct.
Just like Netflix predicts what I should watch, right?
For sure. It's moving there, and of course we are trying to help enable the operators to move there faster.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's the big challenge, isn't it? And as you said, you know, with 5G coming, there's a lot of really big challenges then to think about. Where am I putting my time and effort and resource? Because they can't be everything. But I think the big thing that I'm hearing this week here at Mobile World Congress is that, you know, Ericsson's got a story around all of these key challenges that, you know, one of the things that I was talking with someone else earlier today about is carriers and operators in particular should come to you earlier in the conversation rather than later to sort of try and look for avoiding all those pitfalls and learning the things themselves, because you've got visibility across almost all carriers and all networks and, you know, 183 countries or whatever. So it's usually the case that you have seen it before, done it before, and learned something, and you can collaborate and work with them. Is that right?
Actually, what we're doing now, it's now since we have a sort of a good customer base with small and huge operators globally, all the different areas, we are having a customer user group. So we invite the customers to join us, and we, of course, tell them a bit what's coming in the roadmaps and what we should be doing, but we also let the customers speak to each other.
Yeah.
So sometimes they are competitors on the same market, and of course they cannot maybe share as much. But when you look at different use cases and the challenges, it's very common. And
we saw that with the event recently, the OSS BSS user group,
correct,
right?
Correct.
I was astounded. 61 carriers under the same roof for a couple of days, and no one killed each other. You know, and at the end of it, everyone I spoke to over the 3 or 4 days, either on camera or off camera, they were talking about co-compete, collaborate.
Correct.
Even if they're in the same emerging market or existing market, they were looking at, okay, well, how can we partner? Because otherwise we're just competing with each other, which is, you know, that's not going to make any sense.
That's the whole topic, you know, how can we innovate together with the customers?
Yeah.
You know, what's in it for us? What's in it for them? How can we sort of speed this up?
I guess it comes down to no one can be everything to everyone anymore, right? Because it's so big and so scale. Yeah. Now, you touched on artificial intelligence, and you know, I want to clarify, when you're talking about AI, you're predominantly talking about machine learning in particular, right? Models, data analysis, finding patterns. Maybe give us a little bit of insight, I guess, into what you're doing in this space, and particularly how you're applying machine learning to the sorts of decision-making tools and dashboards and whatever you're providing to customers.
Yeah, I think, of course, AI machine learning is the sort of a hot buzzword. Everybody has been talking about it for a couple of years. I think we start, of course, now to see it coming into our products in a careful way, because the type of solutions we now bring to market with this, I would say, real-time analytics solutions, if you bring the wrong type of models, you can basically, you know, screw up the whole system. So you need to be able, of course, make sure that it's a battle-proven 24/7 type of model. It's not for offline use, it's for real-time use. So one thing that we are actually launching this week here is what we call the machine learning execution environment. Think about it, that you have different teams, different organizations, maybe universities, customers, everybody can write different AI models.
Right.
How do you then, you know, move them into, you know, training environment to a production environment?
Yep.
How do you train them? How do you monitor them? How do you sort of reuse models for different type of products?
Right.
So this is one environment we're actually showcasing here. We call it the MXE, Machine Learning Execution Environment.
Can't wait to have a play on that.
Yeah, correct. You should try it out a bit. And it's a more of an industrialized way how to train your models, how to move them in and out of production, and making sure that you can reuse different models on the same type of use cases. So it's more how do you scale up AI. It's not just by writing innovative models and then, you know, hard code it into a product. You need an environment to actually manage that, to have the catalogs and have different access rights, security, IP.
Fantastic. Yeah. Well, I guess, you know, when we look at the space of machine learning in particular, I mean, when we think about data science and analytics, you know, everything starts with something like regression, for example. It's a baseline, right? Find the outliers, et cetera. And I know when you're building models, there's a lot of commonalities, but you're putting them in different use cases.
Yeah.
Now, another question for you. Everyone's talking about 5G at a very high level. I'd really like to just get a lot more insight into kind of what analytics and where the fit is for analytics around 5G. So, you know, when we think about 5G, there's a lot of big moving parts in either a physical or virtual sense.
Yep.
Where are you applying analytics and particularly machine learning in that analytics in 5G these days, and where is it going?
Yep. I think I have these discussions, of course, with operators every week now. First, I start with 5G is very much the same as before. It's about getting data in.
Right.
How do we collect the data? And of course, when you look at the 5G deployments, there are many different options for an operator to take a step into 5G. Option 2, option 3, option 7. There are never, you know, different ways. So number one is, of course, just to make sure that you get the right type of data in. What type of KPIs?
Okay.
That's basics, you know, get the data in. Then, of course, the funny stuff comes when you, how should you use that data? What type of new use cases do you sort of enable?
Yeah.
And then, of course, the traditional service will be faster, mobile broadband, but faster.
Right.
You will have new type of KPIs for beamforming or maybe frequency usage, etc. So there will be new KPIs, but the same type of use case, you know, yeah, ensuring the mobile broadband. The other areas, of course, the new use cases like IoT.
Okay.
So there will be a lot of new type of use cases and workflows defined to understand, okay, how do you introduce IoT, you know, the mission critical type of IoT applications,
yeah,
that's a completely new area. So I think it will be a stepwise approach now to, you know, making sure that operators can, you know, just get the data in a safe way, start to use the same type of use cases, but it's running on 5G instead of 4G or 3G,
okay,
and then gradually move into the new type of use cases where you need new type of data sets. But again, it's no, the solution is prepared. We are deploying EA, Expert Analytics, now for a number of customers and helping them with their 5G journey.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it will be a gradual now, of course, expansion. And the first use case that is hot right now is, of course, to understand and help the operators, where should they deploy?
Right.
So looking at their 3G, 4G network today, which customers are having experience issues, for what,
okay,
reasons, in what areas?
Yeah.
Where do I benefit the most to expand with 5G? Where should I start? So it's the what we call the 5G planning use case is the first one. And then, of course, in parallel, to understand the experience of the new 5G services.
Right, right. Well, that's always the big question, isn't it? Because, I mean, when we think about telcos and operators, they've traditionally had very big sunk costs. They put sort of, you know, 10 or 15 year ROI models on,
yeah,
these things, and now they're sort of expected to go from 10 or 15 years to 8 months to now days and hours.
Yeah, yeah.
So they're always asking the question, well, where do I put my money? Where do I invest? What infrastructure do I put in place?
Yeah, yeah.
And I guess the big upside now is that you've got tools and models and systems where you can actually put all the data together, get a view of it, and start to play those models out.
Yeah.
And I guess then scale those models across to your cloud, saying, well, okay, well, let's run a 3-year plan on this,
yep,
and see what it looks like. Because you've got, you know, listening today to some of the announcements coming out, you've got massive IoT, you've got critical IoT, you've got,
yep,
cellular IoT. Each of these are complex in their own, and you've got,
yeah,
multiple tiers, right? And it's an exciting time.
Yep, yep.
So, last question for you. Mobile World Congress, an exciting event.
Yep.
Flashy, cool, love it. Lots of good demos.
Yep.
But it's always the case that after the event, there's a lot of homework to be done. There's a lot of interest, a lot,
yep,
of inquiry, a lot of follow-up. Where do you see the next 12 to 18 months be sort of, you know, going for you and your team around what you're doing with, I guess, the analytics and insurance piece in particular, but also where customers are going to take you? Because I think a lot of what you're doing is you're doing a lot of innovation yourselves, but clients,
yeah,
are driving the demand of, okay, well, help us fix this problem,
right,
take us there. So it's a lot of sort of market-driven demand. Where do you see this taking in the next year and a half? Where are the big shifts, trends going?
Yeah, I think, as I said, that this customer user group, where we invite customers to speak to each other, and we open up with more outside in innovation together with the customers.
Yeah.
So we are, this MXE environment, for example, we are now putting that into place with different customers. So we,
right,
can enable the customers to come and play, bring their models.
Fantastic.
We bring some models. So I think the AI space will definitely be sort of the hottest area. Then, of course, supporting them on the journey to you know, be 5G,
right,
ready.
Yep.
So those are the two main things. And at the same time, you know, it's about data. So
yep,
it's all about figuring out these new type of use cases, but of course in collaboration with the lead customers that we have here. So
okay,
exciting times.
It is indeed. Well, you know, one of the themes that I'm seeing this year in particular, and certainly at MWC 19, is a whole bunch of collaborative work with your clients and also their competitors in many ways, and that you've got people working on a common problem for the good of everyone.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I love the way that data science and analytics and so forth is being applied to this and leveraging machine learning, because we can speed things up.
Yep.
You know, we're not taking, as I said, 10 or 15 years to learn,
correct,
something now. We're doing,
yeah,
it really quickly.
Correct.
And I think we're going to see, you know, shorter time to market, shorter time to monetization ROI, but also a shorter time to better types of services, the quality of service, because as a consumer, I love hearing about these big industrial things moving,
yeah,
but
yeah,
I always ask, what's in it for me, right?
Yeah, correct.
How am I going to benefit?
You also raise the bar. You expect more and more and more. So.
Every year, right?
Yeah.
And particularly the different use cases we're around the world with new emerging markets. We're not just making phone calls anymore. We're making video calls, and
right,
we're moving lots of data and so forth. And as you said, the different types of handoff.
Yeah.
Well, it's an exciting exciting event.
Yep.
Congratulations on what's happening on the floor. I can't wait to get my hands on,
yeah,
it.
Yeah, you need to come and visit us and play around. Yeah.
Definitely will. And yeah, thank you so much for making time to catch up with me and sharing some insights and kind of what you're doing here at the event and what's happening elsewhere with your team and so forth. And I think we've got an exciting year and a half ahead of us as that goes beyond Mobile World Congress and out to the broad world.
Yes, thank you.
Fantastic. Well, congratulations and thanks for your time again.
Thank you.
Cheers.